you do not have to agree with me. I don't want you to agree with me. It's much more interesting if you don't, and it does not affect your grade whatsoever. And if you do get involved in things and you go out and get arrested or something, I'll do everything I can to get you out of jail, but I'm not going to give you a better grade for it. So just so we're clear on that. And they're doing this documentary on me, which embarrasses me highly. But really what they're trying to do is look at the movements that I've been a part of for the last 50 years through the lens of my life. And I know enough about the way people respond now that I know that that is valid, if it just weren't me, that people are more interested in people than in ideas initially. But once they get interested in the people, they'll move on to what the ideas are.
They were people who were labeled the rebels, the renegades, the outliers. People who weren't afraid to be called crazy, or in Ella Baker's case, difficult, in Ann Braden's case, red. Dreamers that catapult us into a different place. She was born at a time in the Jim Crow South in which there was a very rigid script about what a middle-class white woman could be and do. And pretty much Ann Braden violated every page of that script with great pride.
Is written as a letter to Jesus, and it's titled A Prayer on My 13th Birthday. It begins, "Dearest Lord Jesus, I have today stepped out of the first phase of my life. I have entered my teens. Childhood is behind me, girlhood before me. I do not like this feeling of forever being banned from the beautiful, glorious land of childhood. I've had such a grand time in this beautiful land. Therefore, I put my hand to the plow today." I think she never took her hand off of that plow.
How do you explain for yourself the pathway of this little religious girl to that place?
Well, okay, I'll try to answer that. I always considered Alabama home. I grew up in Anniston. I don't know whether anybody here has ever heard of Anniston, Alabama. If you have, it's where they burned the Freedom Ride bus in 1961. But I grew up there, and all the people that I grew up with really felt that they were in this privileged position because they were the most superior. There was a woman who would come one day a week and help Mother clean the house, and she would bring her daughter sometimes, and she would sit waiting for her in the kitchen. You know, I'd look at that, and they got our hand-me-down clothes, right? And I'd look at her, and she was fatter than I was, and they never quite fit, and I'd look at her, you know, and I know something happened to me when I looked at her. You just knew something was wrong. You knew something was wrong, and I am convinced that was a reality in our lives. And when I've look back, what I compare it to is photography. If you've ever done photography, you put the film in the development fluid and it begins to come clear, but it's been there all along. My father always said his great mistake was educating me. Thought I got my radical ideas at Randolph Macon Women's College, which confounded them some years later too. But by that time, we were fighting the Nazis. And to a certain extent, people were aware that we were fighting their ideology of racial superiority. And it was hard to think about that and not begin to think about it a little bit at home. So I think those ideas were fermenting. We considered ourselves the New South. All through history, there's somebody coming along saying there's a New South. But we considered ourselves the New South, and we rejected our parents' ideas of segregation, sort of kind of like we rejected their ideas about sex, which we did. None of us were going to get married. I decided that, you know, I'd be a newspaper reporter. And I went to Birmingham and worked on the newspaper there, and I covered the courthouse. And I remember, and there was a number of famous cases like this, and I actually saw one of them, where this African-American man got 20 years in prison because this white woman got up and testified that he had passed her on the road, across the road, and looked at her in an insulting way. And he was charged with assault with intent to ravish. Everything became a story. That's the occupational hazard of journalism. You're up on a mountain somewhere, and there are all these little Lilliputian creatures down below engaged in these Lilliputian battles that you're watching. In the mornings before I came downtown, I would call the courthouse to see anything big happen overnight. Because if there had, I'd have to skip breakfast usually and go on to the courthouse and get the details and get it into the first edition of the afternoon paper. When I would get downtown, I often stopped for breakfast and met a friend there. And the waitress was putting our food down on the table. And so he said, "Anything doing?" And I said, "No, just a colored murder." And I don't think I'd have ever thought anything about it if that black waitress hadn't been standing there. She was pouring coffee into our cups, and her hand was sort of shaking, but there wasn't an expression on her face. It was like she had a mask. And my first impulse was that I wanted to get up and go put my arms around her and say, "Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean that. It's not that I don't think the life of your people is important. It's my newspaper that says what news is." And then I just suddenly realized I'd meant exactly what I'd said. Our society, the one that had nurtured us and been pretty good to us, been pretty good to me, our family, our friends, the people we loved, I never quit loving them, were just plain wrong. And that is painful. You really have to turn yourself inside out. You know, I came here from Birmingham, Alabama, running away from Alabama, I think, because I couldn't stand the way things were there. And it really wasn't any different here in terms of racial segregation. The whole downtown was segregated, the schools, the parks, the library, everything. Plus, not only segregated, there were just so many places blacks couldn't go. Most of the hospitals in this town did not admit black people. And yet, even then, people in the power structure here were saying that we really had very good race relations and that people got on fine and that there just may be some problems, but they were certainly being solved sort of thing.
All of those streets had different names once they went through the black community. And that sounds crazy, but that's true. Whites did not want that street to be the street they lived on.
I was in a prison, and life builds prisons around the people, and I had prison that I was born white in a racist society. I was born privileged in a classist society.
The hardest thing was class. I don't know that I could have ever broken out of what I call the race prison if I hadn't dealt with class. It's that assumption that is so embedded in you that you don't realize it's there, that the people, that your crowd is supposed to be running things.
I came in touch with people who were not just feeding the hungry, but asking the question of why are people poor? And not only asking, but organizing.
Carl Braden had that class consciousness. He had grown up on the wrong side of the tracks. He was raised in a Eugene Debs socialist family, left-leaning, very radical. So they saw themselves as part of this energetic and growing post-World War II militant labor movement.
Somebody asked me out there, that you did get married after all. I said, yeah, I met a different sort of man. We got married to work together.
You know, Anne always used to say that she was a glutton for life. She wanted it all, and she really did. And so she was trying to combine marriage and full-time activism and now motherhood as of 1951.
When I was just beginning to get involved in things, the old-fashioned kind of lynching was on the decline, although that did happen too. But courtrooms were lynching people, and one of them was a man named Willie McGee in Mississippi, who had been framed on a charge of raping a white woman. The Civil Rights Congress had been carrying on a campaign, and they were getting delegations of white women to go to Mississippi. I'd never done anything. I was really not dry behind the ears. And had just gotten into things, never been done anything like this before in my life, and I decided I wanted to go. Jackson was a garrison state that day. There were state police. There were rumors that African Americans were coming in from all over the countryside to protest that day, and there had been a lot of organization there around this case. People were coming. We were headed for the Capitol, and they stopped us, wanted to know where we were going, and I said, "We're going to see the governor." And, "Oh, no, nobody's seeing the governor of Mississippi today." So they took us into what they call protective custody, took us to jail. There was one cop on the back seat with us, there was one driving, one in the front, and then there was another woman back there. And they were mumbling about how these outsiders coming into Mississippi, and we didn't understand about Mississippi, and, you know, just muttering like people will do in a situation like that. And I couldn't stand any longer, and I said, well, I don't really think I'm an outsider. I said, I was a child in Jackson, and I'm ashamed of this state today. And he got absolutely furious. I get, you know, it's the whole traitor thing. That was a very revealing moment to me, because all of my life, police had been on my side. They didn't bother you, you know, in the world where I grew up, except maybe if you were speeding, they might stop you, and if you talked to them real nice, they wouldn't give you a ticket. I mean, and all of a sudden, I realized that I was on the other side.
They didn't stop the execution, but when she came back to Louisville, she talked about the case, wrote extensively about the case, and used that experience as a consciousness-raising tool, not just for herself, but for many other people. She says, I believe that no white woman reared in the South, or perhaps anywhere else in this racist country, can find freedom as a woman until she deals in her own consciousness with the question of race. We grow up little girls, absorbing 100 stereotypes about ourselves and our role in life, our secondary position, our destiny to be a helpmate to a man or men. But we also grow up white, absorbing the stereotypes of race. The picture of ourselves is somehow privileged because of the color of our skin. The two mythologies become intertwined, and there's no way to free ourselves from one without dealing with the other. Well, that's a pretty powerful statement of intersectionality right there.
What she argued basically was that if white Southern women allowed themselves to become the occasion for these racist assaults on black communities, and specifically black men, that they were no less guilty of the production of racism than any other institution. And while there weren't a lot of people who agreed with her at the time, she was principled.
This was 1951. She wrote about it in the black newspaper here in town. She spoke in black churches. And William Patterson, who was head of the Civil Rights Congress, said to Anne, you don't need to tell black people about this problem. You don't need to speak to blacks about this. You need to talk to other white people because they're the problem.
He said, you know, you do have a choice. You don't have to be a part of the world of the lynchers. You can join the other America, the people who struggled against slavery, the people who rebelled against slavery, the white people who supported them, the people who all through Reconstruction struggled. He came on down through history of the people who have struggled against injustice, the other America. And you know, sometimes people will say just what you need to hear at that point. I was very young, and that's what I needed to hear, and that's what I felt like I joined.
The other America was the America that's seeing white folks, that was seeing white folks join in and clearly understand that they have a responsibility too. We're all human beings.
Andrew Wade lived in the West End, and he had a little child, 3 years old, exactly the same age, just about as our son. And his wife was expecting another baby. And so they wanted to move outside the city, which was what was sort of in the air. That's what people were doing, whites were anyway. Moving to the big thing was moving to the suburbs, get out of the city. So they started looking for a house and figured they'd be able to find one. But every time that the real estate agent saw Andrew and realized he was black, the deal was off.
I talked to a white realtor, and he advised me point blank. He said, Wade, let's be realistic. If you see a house, you like the house, regardless of where it is, get a white person, if necessary, if it's in a white neighborhood, to buy the house for you and transfer it to you. He said, it's that simple.
It was a little ranch-type stone house. Looked just like a thousand houses people were putting up with great speed in the suburbs in those days. Andrew gave us the money for the down payment, and Jimmy, our son's with us. He wasn't quite three then. Renrone looked at me and said, I bet he's going to get a pony when he gets out there, you know. Well, we came on home and met Andrew and gave him the keys to the house. Andrew began going out there and sort of moving some stuff in. Roan came over and said, are you working on this house for the Bradens? And he said, no, I'm moving into it. He said, you're what? He said, yeah, I bought it. So then Roan just exploded. It was their first night out there. The front window had been broken out with rocks. There was a rock with a threatening note on it. And then in a little while, somebody fired shots into the house.
I saw five men formed around a cross. Then I saw one of the men throw a match, and it looked like Little Mississippi to me.
And then that Monday, at noon, it came on the radio that the Supreme Court had ruled school segregation illegal. It was May 17th, 1954.
White Southerners called it Black Monday because they saw the most profound challenge yet to their segregated way of life.
They want to throw white children and colored children into the melting pot of integration, out of which will come a conglomerated, blotter, mongrel class of people. Both races will be destroyed in such a movement. I, for one, under God, will die before I yield one inch to that kind of a movement.
Andrew and Charlotte kept going out there every night, which took a huge amount of courage. And then we formed a way defense committee.
Somebody called and said, can you handle a gun? You know, I'm not a violent man. I'm a peaceful man, but I believe in self-defense. And they said, come out. And I came out, they gave me a gun, then explained that they were being harassed. Then I saw the brick through the window. Then I was in a house under siege.
We thought things were dying down. And the phone rang, and it was Andrew. And he said, we're all right, but they just blew the house up.
They were out, came back in, and were standing on the porch with the guards when a charge of dynamite blew up the back half of the house. The chilling thing being that it was set right under their little three-year-old daughter's bedroom. And thus began a kind of a campaign of nerves, really, because it took quite a long time for the grand jury to convene to investigate.
I was working out at my job at GE, and a guy tapped me on the shoulder, and he said, you're coming with me, I have a bench warrant. Took me in, walked in the door, took me up the stairs, opened the door, and there was a grand jury sitting around. I was all prepared to talk about the house and so forth. And he asked me my name and address. I swear to tell the truth, yes. And then he asked me, are you now or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? And I was offended because, you know, there was a bombing crime. I thought we were going to ask about the bombing. And I said, that's none of your damn business.
In October of 1954, Ann and Carl and five other whites that had acted to support the Wade's right to the house were charged with what was called sedition.
Scott Hamilton said the purchase of the house, the resale of it, and the bombing had all been a plot by communists to stir up trouble between the races and in that manner to bring about the overthrow of the government of Kentucky and the United States. That's what he said.
To think that she and Carl were charged with sedition and overthrowing the whole state of Kentucky because they had bought a house for black people. It's mind-boggling to me now that she went through that. And they paid a very heavy price. They paid a heavy price with their children, with Ann's parents.
I was in jail about a week. Then Carl got out in about 3 weeks. And we left the next day to go to Alabama and see the children. Jim, who just adored his father, was sleeping there in the room and in his bed, and he came over and got in bed with us, and he still sucked his thumb. His eyes were shining. He was so glad that we were there. Then that night, our lawyer called, and we'd been indicted, five of us had been indicted again on charges of actually blowing up the house.
they were not thought to be spies. Nobody thought that about them. So what is it that they're subverting, really? Except, in the case of the Waits, housing segregation. That's what they were subverting.
It's so hard to describe this feeling that there were people out there that would have liked to have killed us, you know, and talked about it. And that began to build up really during the grand jury and after our indictment, and then kind of reached a height, I think, during Carl's trial. Carl's trial was really of books. You see, they raided our house. We had a lot of different books, books by Marx and Lenin, but they really didn't know the difference. I had been very interested in Russian literature at an earlier period in my life, so they took the novels by Turgenev and Tolstoy and anything with a Russian name. People were literally going through their libraries to see if they might have any books that would be suspect, taking them off the shelves, wrapping them up in sheets, weighting them down with rocks, and throwing them in the Ohio River.
We, the jury, find that defendant Carl Braden guilty as charged in the indictment. Fixed his punishment to confinement in the penitentiary for a term of 15 years and a $5,000 fine.
The anti-communist sort of hysteria that was gripping the country and the anti-black hysteria that was certainly gripping the South all got rolled up in a ball and hurled at us. We were traitors to our race. We were communists. We were evil. We were the devil.
While the mildest kinds of white liberals might very well get tarred with the communist brush, that was not the politics of Ann and Carl Braden. They were left-wing. They were avowed socialists. They had embraced the Communist Party in terms of their networks, their friends, the causes they espoused. They were critics of capitalism, and they were critics of racism.
Worst of what happened in the 50s wasn't what happened to individuals, even the ones that were most hurt. It was what happened to this country, because you had although you always had a resistance movement, people who never did become silent. That's what we met as we traveled the country, those people. But for the most part, most people were frightened, and they did quit going to meetings. They quit signing petitions. You know, somebody went out with the Bill of Rights, nobody would sign it, you know, that kind of thing. People were scared to express themselves.
It was unbelievable. When you look back at it, you know, but then there was this hysteria, and they whipping it up, and you know what got us, what I understand, what got Carl sprung was the Supreme Court of the United States. We appealed to the Supreme Court, threw the law out because you couldn't commit sedition against the state. It was a federal offense. It was a technicality.
We used this attack on us as a platform to reach more people with what we'd been talking about anyway, which was segregation and housing. And racism. If you do that, if you use every attack as a platform, they can't win and you can't lose, because if they leave you alone, you're going right on organizing. If they attack you, you're going to have a platform to reach a lot more people, so you really can't lose. And it really works like a charm.
Carl had been employed by the Courier-Journal, but the day after he was convicted, he was fired. All of the other defendants lost their jobs, and the Southern Conference Educational Fund, SCEF, hired Ann and Carl as field organizers and as editors of the Southern Patriot newspaper.
I knew Ann before I first saw her, because I read the Southern Patriot. It was through the Southern Patriot that I realized all the other people that were in movement in the South. It was in the Southern Patriot that I began to realize the background that made it possible for all of us to be active in the South. And Anne knew it. She was writing it. She always wanted it to be. She was using her total self to change the South.
There was always somebody coming to a board meeting thinking, maybe we better adopt a resolution, we don't admit communism, for the survival of the organization. Because, and people were doing that all over the place. They were having purge. The ACLU had a purge, the NAACP had long before had purged its ranks. And Jim Dombrowski said, I don't know that it's that important whether SCEF survive.
But he said, I think it's important that some hope for American democracy survive. And if we join in this witch hunt, we'll be helping to destroy any hope of democracy. That shut everybody up. I don't believe it came up on that board again. SCEF got stronger and stronger. Every time we were attacked, we got stronger because we won new support, you see, because we learned how to use it as a platform. And we survived basically because we fought back.
I think we've got to think about and find a way to keep our positive program for integration going in the South. And if we don't do that, I think the Un-American Committee has accomplished its purpose.
Heroism, if you can use that term, although I don't think a person is being a hero because he does what he thinks is right. I don't think we should strive for hero worship. We ought to just do the thing because it is right and because God expects us to do that.
Negro pastor heads Communist Front. That was the headline. When I was elected president of SCEF.
They challenged
segregation at its core. Its core had to be Birmingham, Alabama.
Birmingham had to have somebody with the individual guts that Fred Shuttlesworth had, which he says he got from his religious faith, and I'm sure he did. But his church was bombed on Christmas night, and he lived right next to the church, and the bomb, they set the bomb, and it went off right between the church and the house, blew up one side of the church and one side of his house, and he was lying in bed right under where the bomb went off in the house when it went off. They never found the springs of that bed. And with such force that it pushed splinters through the wall, and he did not get a scratch.
My house was bombed. House and church was bombed. Twice while I was passing there, and once after I left there. You can't kill an idea anyway, especially if somebody else catches hold to it. To a segregationist, integration means communism. And so I equated my work against race baiting just like I did against segregation. That people who believe what they believe and would stand for it anywhere, I thought they were saints of the highest magnitude.
Our faith cries out, we have no fear. We dare to reach our hand to other neighbors far and near, to friends in every land. Isn't this a time? Isn't this a time to free the soul of man? Isn't this a...
We don't break down segregation at Mount Cherry Park. We've been talking about that for 5 years. We ought to do it this year. You won't be here, though. We'll have to wait till Daddy gets out of jail.
No, you're not scared, are you?
Who, me? No, but I wouldn't want Daddy to miss it.
I told him he was going to jail for what was right.
Well, I think that was pretty good for a beginning.
That's the answer, that I'm going to jail for what is right.
They took him down there, and they asked him some questions. Was he a communist? Has he been a communist or a member of the Communist Party? And he refused to answer the questions on the ground of the First Amendment. And the First Amendment is freedom of association, freedom of speech.
We feel that it'll be worthwhile to go to jail if it alerts the American people to the dangers posed to their liberties.
I'd like to add something to that. The Un-American Activities Committee will be abolished because it is unconstitutional. And
well, if anyone comes, if they don't like it.
It's a press conference. Newspaper man.
Do you think you could do it in Moscow, too?
Come on.
I know about you.
All of you can come up if you want to. Come on. Come on up, you little grateful.
Thank you.
This loop here, or there's going to be trouble.
Putting roses on me? You keep it. The roses are for you.
It was a very sad occasion. No one wants to see anyone go to prison. And I think we were all aware that he was doing this because of his principal belief in equality and justice and democracy, and that that finally he would prevail.
Martin Luther King spearheaded the petition that was asking for Carl's clemency in 1961. He sent them a copy of the first hardback edition, Stride Toward Freedom, The Montgomery Story, and he autographed it this way: to my friends Carl and Ann Braden, whose genuine goodwill and great humanitarian concern have contributed much in the constant stride toward freedom.
The whole theory of the right of free speech is not your right to speak, but my right to hear. That was absolutely the rock bottom essential to have any sort of representative government or democracy, is that people be able to examine all ideas and look at them. So if they don't get a chance to hear the ideas, that can't happen. So the real reason you need freedom of speech is so people can hear different ideas, not just because I want to get up, pop off, and speak. See, I say it guarantees the right to organize, because your right to speak, to meet, to print, to petition the government, that's organizing is what it is. It's the freedom to organize against policies of the government that are wrong. It was born in struggle. It was because people insisted on, and there's been a struggle ever since to make it mean something. And the only time it's meant something is when people struggled for it.
Civil rights cannot be achieved without civil liberties. That what Ann called the Southern police state has got to be broken down to win the right to dissent, period.
Five of us in a senior sociology class were assigned a paper on the race question. Write a paper about the race problem and present solutions to the problem. So we were going to go interview Dr. King and Rosa Parks and E.D. Nixon, who had made the Montgomery bus boycott. When we got back to college, we were confronted by the whole administration. They met us and they said, you've gone to a meeting, you've broken the segregation laws, you have to resign from school. That night, the Klan burnt crosses around the dormitory, and then two nights later, there was a huge rally of the Klan. They burned a 38-foot cross. This was huge something in Montgomery. And we're students, you know. We said, what in the world? The whole world's come to the end because we went to a black church? And then we were called to the Attorney General's office, and he said, you've fallen under the communist influence. And I said, you mean communists are in Alabama? And he said, no, but they come through here. So that was where I met Ann Braden. The first thing out of his mouth was Ann Braden. And of course, she got in touch with me. And when she did, I said, well, this is finally the outside world. My first job at SNCC was actually paid for by SCEF to have a campus traveling program. So the first staff meeting I went to was in Macomb, Mississippi. I joined the march and was beaten, arrested, and almost lynched that first meeting. They kept calling me a goddamn nigger-loving, motherfucking son-of-a-bitch Jew from New York. Communist son-of-a-bitch. And I said, well, 9 out of 10 is not bad, but I am not from New York. Ann had taught us that you can be against red baiting, you can be for an open political discussion, you can be against segregation, you can be for integration and so forth, and you can still be a good Southerner, and you can still be a good person and a normal person.
One of the things that she just would not talk about was Anita's death. It was at the height of the civil rights movement when the child was diagnosed with a rare heart and lung disorder that wouldn't be fatal today. They took her all over the place. They took her, I mean, she was 10 years old when she was diagnosed. She really was like the light of their lives. Ella Baker came and stayed with Ann for a couple of weeks after it happened, because Ann just couldn't stop. Her way of dealing with grief was to plunge deeper into the work. And Ella said, no, you've got to stay and grieve this. You've got to just be still.
This march will not continue. Is that clear to you?
Among the performers in the Selma to Montgomery March were high-ranking members of the Southern Conference Education Front, officially identified as a communist front group. Mr. Carl Braden of Louisville, Kentucky. Mr. Braden, what is your connection with the demonstration march from Selma to Montgomery?
Well, I have no official connection with the demonstration march from Selma to Montgomery. I am here as a journalist and an observer. The interview was interrupted this time
by federal security officers checking the camera crew's credentials. This might be an appropriate time to review Carl Braden's record.
Mr. Braden, identified before congressional committees as a Communist Party member, has served a federal sentence for contempt of Congress and was convicted in Kentucky for the crime of sedition, conspiring to overthrow a duly constituted government by force.
Carl Braden and his wife, Anne, have served as a publicity corps for King's Southern Christian Leadership Conference, while also working for the Communist Front organization, the Southern Conference Education Front.
I was working at the Southern Regional Council at the time, and she said to me, well, I can't come there. We're not allowed to even go into that office. I think she wanted to make contact. She was... absolutely. This is where she was fearless. She would talk to anybody. She would talk to her worst enemy. She was the conscience of civil liberties for the movement.
She started by defining racism as a systemic danger. Then she talked about how devastating racism was for the targeted group, and all of the different ways you could twist and distort the lives of a group if you had a racist system in place. And then she quieted her voice, and she talked about the devastation that would take place within any human being who actually practiced racism or participated in supporting a system that was racist. And she insisted that you couldn't just sit and wish for things to be better. You had to actually pick up your life and put your life in the way of the evil and dare the evil to strike you down, because you were not going to change who you were for anything.
It's a different country because of what happened in the 1960s, and that happened because young people, some of them not any older than some of the people here who are young, 14, 15, 16 years old, all through the South, stood up and said, we're going to change this thing, and we will risk our lives, and they did, and some of them gave their lives. They were trying to be able to sit at a lunch counter and get a cup of coffee. Well, you don't risk your life for a cup of coffee. They were trying to get the right to vote, which is terribly important. But I'm not sure you risk your life even the right to vote. They risked their lives because they had a vision of a whole different world. They were going to remake the world, and in a sense, they projected a vision of a different kind of society, where people's needs came first, where people cooperate instead of dog eat dog, trying to step on another person. They had a dream. They called it the beloved community. Not just a community where people would love each other, but a just community for everybody. They had that vision, and it was young people who made the difference.
nonviolent direct action was people themselves taken to the streets.
The black movement in the South shook the whole society. It was like the foundation stone was hit and the whole structure shook, because it brought everything into question. Because so much in this country is based on race and the exploitation and oppression of African Americans. So once you, that's challenged, everything shakes.
What we were about was destroying the structures that could be used to intimidate decent, honest people on every hand. The idea was to open the possibilities that we could all speak out, fully knowing who we were, what we meant, and if we were wrong, then correct us with thought. And if you were wrong, then come on over to our side. That's what we've been saying to America.
We're willing to be beaten for democracy, and you misuse democracy in the street. You beat people bloody in order that they will not have the privilege to vote. You beat me in the side and then hide your blows.
The most important contribution that the civil rights movement of the 60s made was it broke the police state in the South.
But even at that, it didn't get to the heart of the matter, because the real problem was economic. And the March on Washington, that's, you know, 1963, the big one that everybody talks about, was a march for jobs and freedom. But people have forgotten that it was for jobs and freedom, you know?
I frankly, you all, find it hard to get through every January. Because I know all the phony stuff I'm going to have to listen to about Dr. Martin Luther King.
Yeah.
Because the powers that be in this country have just totally distorted what that man was. They put him on a pedestal. You see, he looks like a dreamer. He wasn't a dreamer, he was a revolutionary. I may not know a lot, but I know something about white folks because I've been one for 80 years. And I know that us white folks, we will do anything in the world rather than face the truth about what white racism, and I prefer to call it white supremacy, which is what it is, has done to us and to the country. But this is a very comfortable image of the little black and white children walking the red hills of Georgia together. Well, of course you'd like to have that happen, but it takes more than that, right? It's very different from what he was saying in his Riverside Church speech when he said, among other things, true compassion is more than flinging coins to a beggar. True compassion recognizes that a society that creates beggars needs to be totally restructured.
I come to this magnificent house of worship tonight because my conscience leaves me no other choice. A time comes when silence is betrayal. That time has come for us in relation to Vietnam.
After he made that speech, the wrath of this country descended on him, of the powerful people in this country. The Washington Post wrote an editorial, the New York Times wrote, they were all saying he's lost his value to the black community, he's lost his effectiveness as a civil rights leader, and he's alienated his natural allies. And Vincent Harding says Dr. King had decided long ago the federal government wasn't among his natural allies.
The black left essentially was one of the most important casualties of the civil rights era, because the fundamental compromise that the King was always under pressure to make and others were always under pressure to make is that if you distance yourself from the left, you know, the far left, because of its association with communism and so forth, you know, we will ally ourselves with you to support moderate, middle-of-the-road racial reform. So that meant, of course, that people like Paul Robeson, people like Du Bois and others became expendable. You know, and Du Bois talked about, you know, back in the before World War I and in the 20s, you know, there's got to be a better American dream for African Americans than being just like white Americans.
Now we've got to make this march our march. This has got to be the march for the black people in Mississippi. We've got to go to every little place and get every black man and black woman, black boy and black girl out who's not afraid. And let's make this our Mississippi.
Black power! Black power!
They realized that blacks ought to head the struggle. And they really felt like that. They didn't feel like any place was too important or too high for blacks to be.
One thing about Ann never gave no message to black folks what they should do.
Ann's message was always what white folks need to do. You need to join this other America. And from her organizing white folks, she instilled in me that, you know, I can't organize your community. I can't organize black folks. You got to do this job. That's your responsibility. And that was the amazing thing about that little lady.
SNCC began having struggles over two key political questions. One was whether to continue nonviolent response to that murderous violence that was taking place with dynamite and shooting people, killing people. The other was the whole role of white anti-racist fighters if some of us were to work with poor white people. These are some FBI files. You'll see this is an FBI agent who's got a copy of this somehow and wrote note on it. SCEF's role has always been to reach the white Southerner and bring him into action in coalition with the black Southerner. Never has this been so necessary as it is today. In fact, the future of our nation may depend upon it. Furthermore, we believe that never has it been as possible as it is today. You can just hear Anne, this is the way she would talk.
We have to go organize the white people. We have a program to do that. It's called GROW, grassroots organizing work. Get rid of Wallace. In the GROW project, we don't want to appeal to people's consciousness, their Christianity, their love, or anything like that, because everybody who could be appealed to on that basis is already in. We now have to say it is to your material benefit for you to put aside racist practices and behavior, no matter what your thoughts are, and get together with your fellow black workers and improve your situation, because you have always been fed a bill of goods by the rich people. Accept poor schools, accept poor clothing and medical care. And what do you get in exchange? Racial superiority? You know, that's crazy.
You know, here is the Southern Mountain Project. That was Margaret and me. Here's GROW, that's Bob and Dottie. Here's the Southern Patriot. In April of 1967, April Fool's Day, we drove to the mountains.
The factories and the coal mines are owned by very few people, and it's these people that have democracy in this country. But for the great majority of the working and poor people in this country, there is no democracy.
Our very presence in the mountains tells people what we stand for, which is that poor and working class people have to control the government themselves or they're going to be exploited.
We had set up what we called our Southern Mountain Project because we thought that's where we could recruit whites. Well, of course, we got under attack immediately and they were, you know, saying all the Reds were taking over the mountains in Pikeville and we got indicted for sedition and all that kind of stuff.
We've got some valuable land down here that men like him have just finished augering my property. I'm putting out fruit trees and things like that on them. Well, these people, they come in the restaurant, they smell. You come to us like a damn bunch of beatniks, and we'll treat you like beatniks. Yeah. Now, my friend, you better believe it. You're treading on damn dangerous ground. Why? Because we don't like the way you dress. We don't like your fuzzy damn faces. We don't like your boots. We don't like that. We don't like no part of it.
I remember when they came into the house, Sheriff Justice was there, Perry Justice, also an undertaker, and he had a Polaroid. We called it a paranoid Polaroid, and he was taking pictures of me, and he said, hold your head up so we see what you look like when we hang you. And I'm sitting on this couch, and I'm scared shitless. And Margaret gets the telephone, had a long cord, and she went and locked herself in the bathroom and called up Bill Kunstler. And then she called Ann and Carl and said, they're in here. And Ann and Carl then began calling people all across the country.
We certainly, I hope, don't have to put up with people coming here, financed by tax money, trying to promote Marxism or communism or any kind of subversive activities in eastern Kentucky. I know I don't want to put up with it.
It was really strange. We never ran for public office, never intended to, and yet for years there wouldn't be an election somebody didn't run against us. We always knew when a candidate was going to lose because he'd start accusing his opponent of associating with the Bradens.
Ratliff particularly, and Louis Nunn had thought they were going to ride these headlines about going after the Reds all through November when the election was. And instead, the headline was, no competent lawyer could ever believe that this sedition law was constitutional. You know, it was an ad hominem attack on Ratliff. Dr. King sent me this telegram saying, will you help me organize a poor people's campaign, because they were trying to get some poor white people up there. December 29th, there was, you know, there'd be a story in the Pikeville County News about seditionists have baby or something like that. There was a little story. And we were always worried about Victor's safety and our safety there for, and rightly so. You know, they dynamited us a year later in December of 68. We're going to have a very difficult time overcoming this isolation. We could have if we just said we're going to stay there for 10 years or something, but, you know, that was a terrible time for us.
As you get into the early 70s, that sense of being part of something larger is what gets lost. And, you know, instead of being part of this the big ocean, you know, all of a sudden you've got a few little ponds, a little oases in the desert. And those oases were under siege. Black is beautiful, free away,
said I want you free, free. 70s became a period of FBI repression, the attempt to wipe out the possibility for the further growth and development of these movements. The huge numbers of political activists were imprisoned, were either assassinated or imprisoned. I happened to be one of those persons arrested in 1970, finally acquitted in 1972. There had been a very intense campaign developed around the demand for my freedom. And, of course, Anne and Carl were in the leadership of that campaign.
As a communist, I feel that the people who live in a society, the people who produce the wealth of that society, have a right to that wealth. In this country today, there are millions and millions of poor people. So I feel that the only ultimate solution is to totally restructure the whole economic and political fabric in this country.
We had one committee after another to defend so-and-so, to defend here, person, that person in Alabama, this person in Georgia. And around some of those battles, we were able to mount movements around the counteroffensive. But on the other hand, there was a momentum that was lost in terms of what was happening at that time in challenging the economic and political structures of the country.
When she lost Carl in 1975, that's a young age. She was 50 years old. That was a young age to lose your husband. And she, I think, was deeply traumatized by it. But her way was never to stop or to change course.
Anne did a lot to make me keep the feeling of the ultimate redemption of white people. If Ann had been black, I probably wouldn't have thought the same way I think about white people. But Ann was a white lady, and she was one of the best ladies I've ever known. I mean, most courageous person I've ever known. She used to tell me many times that I was so good at bringing working class white folks and working class black folks together. When I worked at the water company, it was blue collar white guys. We'd go reading water meters from yard to yard, and you know, little kids would follow you around. Well, we were out there that day, and a little boy who looked to be about 5 years old maybe was following us from a few yards over, and his mother was in the door yelling at him. And she was just screaming, top of her lungs, "Jeffrey, didn't I tell you to get in this house? You get in here right now." And finally, Jeffrey looked at me and he said, "Are you a nigger?" I said, "Well, I don't know, Jeffrey. Could be, I'm not sure." And he just kept walking with us and he said, "Do you kill people?" I said, "Well, no, Jeffrey, I don't kill people." He looked at me and he said, "My mother said you kill people." It was during the busing period. The white guy who worked with me began to come to meetings and things. And he ended up by telling me that he had heard his father talking about the N-word, if you will, at the table. And he told his father, "Please don't ever do that again. If you ever do that again, you will never see my daughter again." That shows how he changed, you know? There was a change after we come together. So he was, again, very supportive of those things. And I think that's true with all of us when we get to know one another.
I remember the first morning the buses rolled to pick up the kids, and there were mobs in the street out at some of the places, white mobs, where these kids were going. And I wondered how you'd put your child on a bus to go there. And yet I rode around that morning early and watched the mothers who'd brought their children out to the corner to put them on those buses. You know, why? How do they get the courage to do that? And I think people had faith, well, this is, education's so important. This is going to mean a better education for our kids.
These kind of Leave It to Beaver housewives and these crazed expressions on their faces, throwing rocks at buses with six-year-old children on them. Yeah, I mean, it's just bizarre.
I am not a racist, I'm not a bigot, and I really feel insulted when most people ask me if I am. But if I were, it's unimportant because I am concerned only in the welfare of all children and their education.
When the Klan was reorganizing, they were saying that they were not against black people. They were just for white people. And the problem in this country was that blacks were getting everything and whites were being left out. And you know, we were scared about the Klan reorganizing, but we just laughed at that. We thought, well, isn't that the craziest thing you ever heard? And this was maybe 76 or along in there, never dreaming that within a little over 10 years, that was going to be the line of the Justice Department. More of its discrimination cases were so-called reverse discrimination cases than discrimination against minorities.
Just because I'm white doesn't mean that the 14th Amendment doesn't refer to me either. I am white and I want my rights.
And this idea of reverse discrimination took hold of the country. And I think is the most dangerous idea that's ever been inflicted on this country. It tells white people that the source of their problem is people of color, and it's such a damn lie because it's based on the theory that what black people got took people something away from white people, and that is the opposite of what happened. Every piece of legislation, everything that happened that the black movement won helped most white people and certainly poor and working class white people.
Your families? Are you willing to protect your kids and stop these crimes in every school? White power!
Five young members of the Communist Workers' Party, they were shot down in cold blood. And that so mobilized a counter response. And Ann Braden was one of the key people to pull together a really large regional demonstration and protest. We were told we needed to pass as a Baptist church group. There was a lot of conversation about weaponry and the Klan, and it was a very, you know, for someone that really wasn't political that much, it was a really kind of threatening experience. And then when I got there, it was just huge. It was huge. There were many thousands of people there. And I just remember her voice, that southern white accent. I mean, it was a very strong anti-racist message.
The men who pulled the triggers that killed five people here on the streets of Greensboro are dangerous men who must be brought to justice. But they are not the cause of our problem. They are the result. The real danger today comes from the people in high places, from the halls of Congress to the boardrooms of our big corporations, who are telling the white people that if their taxes are eating up their paychecks, it's not because of our bloated military budget, but because of government programs that benefit black people. Those people in high places who are telling white people that if young whites are unemployed, it's because blacks are getting all the jobs. Our problem is the people in power who are creating a scapegoat mentality. That is what is creating the climate in which the Klan can grow in this country, and that is what is creating the danger of a fascist movement in the 1980s in America.
When I first moved back here, one of the first things I did was call Ann and say, what can I get involved in? And of course, she immediately said, well, come over to my house. I have to make these flyers. And I guess that was the beginning of our formal mentorship. Social justice work is not something you do in your life, but a way it can become your life. And in a way that includes community and deep friendship and love and intellectual activity. She would model with where she put her body. And if I wanted to talk to Anne, the best place to talk to Anne would be on the picket line, on the march. I mean, I can't tell you how many things we worked out just working in the circle when the police abuse protests were taking place. Anne loved to strategize as we were doing the work. And so her mentorship demanded that you be in the movement with your body. You were on the picket line and you were at the demonstration and you were on the bus to Washington or to Birmingham.
It's just living wage, the police brutality, they are abused by the police too.
Because we have the same issues.
Yeah.
We have to get out and talk to the communities and talk to people.
They have to go door to door.
Right.
I say people have lost the art of old door-to-door work.
Right.
Some of them think if they send out an email, people are coming to a meeting.
No.
And they're not.
No.
Half of them don't look at the email, half of them don't have it. But even if there's nothing like somebody calling you on the phone or going to knocking on your door, and said, we need you at this meeting.
Then you are part of the solution they're trying to find.
You just have to get people back to knocking on people's doors, I think, to reach those people you're talking about. I know they want you everywhere, so you can't come back all the time, but come back when you can.
I will. I enjoy coming.
I was coming out as a lesbian. So I went to Anne and told her, we are going to launch this organization called the Fairness Campaign, and we're going to build it broadly with a vision that has anti-racism at its core. And it was so funny because Anne was like, what? And a few years later, it took the Klan coming to town and a huge mobilization. But there were close to 1,000 people downtown, and it was in the rain. And what Anne saw that day was how many lesbian and gay people came to that rally. And afterwards, Anne said to me, she said, Carla, I owe you a tremendous apology. She said, I was wrong. There was homophobia in the civil rights movement, in the women's movement. When the homophobia would come up, she would talk about how it would divide people and how when we shared a commitment to justice, that meant we needed to be in the rooms together.
Her principal stance against racism and the linkages she made among racism and sexism and war and economic injustice and environmental assault, those linkages remain a model. And her inveterate optimism, even in the worst of times, her refusal to give up and her refusal to believe that our dreams have been dashed. She always held up the banner of struggle. Her vision was always focused on the future. And she was an inspiration to us all.
We've got something remarkable here in Louisville, and you are a part of it. We have a coming together from different colors, different parts of town, different issues. Now, I want to say to you, that is somewhat remarkable.
No! No!
The Achilles heel in this country is that we have a mostly white peace movement and a mostly people of color justice movement. We tried to deal with it in the 1960s during the Vietnam War, not very successfully. It's still the Achilles heel. We're talking about the same issue. The issue with us and the police is that the people running this place, to them, they're not going to put it in these words, but to them, the life of a person of color doesn't matter. The trouble in Washington is that to the people running our government, the lives of those people in Iraq don't matter because they're not white. We know we're here. We're the hope of this community, and every one of you is a part of that, and we're going to win.
All right. I go to these meetings, and people talk about we got to build better relations and that sort of thing and all that, and I'm always getting up, and I say, well, first, we got to deal with the whole issue of white supremacy. And it's like you threw a snake on the table. They just don't want to hear. I mean, literally, they look at me. But I don't care. I don't care if they want to. I just have to make myself obnoxious, I guess.
When I think of my dear sister, when I think of my comrade, when I think of he and she, Carl and Ann, who are willing to stand up, straighten up their backs, and sustain that struggle for the long haul. We're talking about a high level of service. Thank God for her award-winning memoir that says, let me tell my story of what it's like to be a white sister, privileged, but also making a moral stand against the system of white supremacy that bestows that white skin privilege on me. And let me do it not because I am better than others, but because I decide to be a human being in a certain kind of way with a certain commitment to justice. That's Anne Braden. Let us pay tribute to our dear sister, Anne Braden. Known not just in Kentucky, not just in America, but around the world as a freedom fighter. And we love you, Sister Ann.
I don't think guilt is a productive emotion. I never knew anybody who really got active because of guilt. Now, people feel, there's plenty of white people feel guilty about, but they'll sit around and they'll feel guilty. They'll go hear a real militant black speaker, beat them over the head for an hour, and go home and think they've done something and not do anything for a year. You know, I've never seen it move anybody. I think what everybody white that I know has gotten involved in this struggle got into it because they glimpsed a different world to live in. The meaning of life is in that struggle that human beings have always been able to envision something better. I don't know where they get it, but that's what makes human beings divine, I think. But whatever, all through history, there have been people who envisioned something better in the most dire situations, you know, and that's what you want to be a part of. You want to see the fruit of it, but that's what you want to be a part of.
Ann would always say, well, I don't have time for this. I can't do this phone call now. You know, or I can't do that. I can't do this. I have so much to do. Up to the end, she was saying, I remember I saw her right before she died. And Ann just looked at me and she said, I just don't have time. And she turned over. She said, not now. You know, and I knew what she meant was, I can't do this dying thing right now because I have too much to do. That's not what you were getting at, but sorry.
We made it, all right? Any change in America we made, and it's not over, because we and our children and our children's children are going to redeem this land sooner or later, all right? All right? That's what we have to understand, right? Our commitment is to the death, and we never give up. Our love of justice is greater than their hatred. It is life that in the end wins. And Braden has won, not for herself, but she's won for the South already. Huh? She's won for this nation already. And she won for you and I. All we have to do is keep it going.
We've been marching for a mighty long time for justice.
Not gonna tolerate it anymore.
We need to keep in mind Clifford Lewis. We need to keep in mind Antoine Brown. We need to keep in mind James Taylor.
Yes.
We need to keep in mind all of them. Desmond Rudolph, Adrian Rimmel, all of them.
That's right.
Have lost their lives and police officers have not been held accountable. We cannot depend on anybody else, but we have to do it ourselves, depending on a mighty God. A mighty God. A mighty God. To make a way out of no way.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes, until the killing of black men, of black mothers' sons, is as important as the killing of white men, white mothers' sons. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it's won.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until the killing of black men, black mothers' sons, is as important as the killing of white men, white mothers' sons. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. That which touches me most is that I had a chance to work with people, passing on to others that which was passed on to me. We who believe in freedom and God,
let's sing it with us. Come on.
We who believe in freedom and God, rest until it comes. To me, young people come first.
They come first.
They have the courage where we fail. And if I can but shed some light as they carry us through the gate. We who believe in freedom and God, secret of my going on is when the reins are in the hands of the young who dare to run against the storm.